Sing, rise up, O men of God. This is our call to worship. Miss Tina, can you give me a little introduction, please? Goes like this. Sing with me if you want to sing. Ready?
Rise up, O men of God. Have done with lesser things. Give heart and mind and soul and strength to serve the King of Kings.
Second verse.
Rise up, O men of God. His kingdom tarries long. Bring in the day of brotherhood and in the might of wrong.
Third verse.
Rise up, O men of God. The church for you doth wait. Her strength in equal to her task. Rise up and make her great.
Last verse, here we go.
Lift high the cross of Christ. Tread where his feet have trod. As brothers of the Son of Man, rise up, O men of God. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and to crown him Lord of all. Forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all.
Let's sing that second verse. Ready?
Ye chosen seed of Israel's race, ye ransomed from the fall. Hail him who saves you by his grace, and to crown him Lord of all. Hail him who saves you by his grace, and crown him Lord of all.
Third stanza, here we go.
Let every kindred, every tribe on this terrestrial ball to him all majesty ascribe and to crown him Lord of all. To him all majesty ascribe and crown him Lord of all.
The last stanza, here we go.
Oh, that with yonder sacred throne we at his feet may fall. The everlasting song and to crown him Lord of all. We'll join the everlasting song and crown him Lord of all.
I am delighted that you are here this morning. Welcome, church family. Welcome, guests. If you're our guest, I want you to know that after being here one Sunday, you're part of our family. So delighted to have you here. I know some of our family is out today with different things. COVID is still a real threat, so some of our family is watching from home. We want to say good morning to you. But it's good to be here on this Lord's Day. Amen. Folks, we have come to worship the Lord, and no doubt maybe this past week was easy for you, maybe it was stressful for you, but we have come today to worship the Lord and to seek what He has for us. And if we come with an open heart, He will reveal to us what we need to do, and we need to be obedient in doing that. So there's peace in that. Whatever is going on in your life right now, know that we have a Heavenly Father that loves you and cares about you, and through faith in Jesus Christ, I'm telling you, that is where the joy and peace come. So delighted that you're here this morning. Be thinking about what the Lord needs to do today and be obedient to what He reveals to you. He's a great God. Let me pray. Father, we thank you for your goodness. Lord, another opportunity to come together. Father, we Lord, we don't even deserve to be alive, but Lord, in your great love and in your grace, Lord, you have offered salvation, and Father, we thank you for that. Thank you for each person, Lord, that has made their way here to worship. Thank you for our family and friends that are watching from home. Lord, we love you. I just pray that everything that is said and done in this hour will be accordance to your will, and Father, if someone needs to make a decision today, Lord, just give them the grace to do that. In Christ's name we pray, amen.
First stanza, here we go.
I gave my life for thee, my precious blood I shed, that thou might ransom me and quicken from the dead. I gave my life for thee. What hast thou given for me? I gave my life for thee. What hast thou given for me?
Sing a verse.
My Father's house of light, my glory's circle throne, I left for earthly might, for wanderings and alone. I left it all for thee. Hast thou left aught for me? I left it all for thee. Hast thou left aught for me?
Let's sing that third. Ready?
I suffered much for thee, more than thy tongue can tell, of bitter agony to rescue thee from hell. I bore it all for thee. What hast thou bore for me? I bore it all for thee. What hast thou bore for me?
Last stanza.
And that I brought to thee down from my home above.
Salvation
full and free. My pardon and my love.
Amen.
I bring rich gifts to thee. What hast thou brought to me? I bring rich gifts to thee. What hast thou brought to thee?
Isn't that a beautiful song? Praise the Lord. I just love that song. God has laid down his life that we might have life and have it more abundantly. Amen. On the old rugged cross, he's no longer there. He's no longer in the cold, dark tomb, but praise God, he lives within our hearts every day. Amen. God bless you. Thank you. Have a great day in the Lord today. I have a special guest for us today. Angie Duval, my daughter, she come and sings for us today. And you pray for her as the Lord just lays upon her heart. I'm going to let her announce it, her song, and then after she sings, Brother Robert's going to come and lead us in our message today. Thank you, Angie.
I'll be singing today, Arms of Love. So pray for me. My voice is kind of giving out, but pray for me as I sing the song. So. Lord, I'm really glad you're here. Sorry. I hope you feel the same when you see all my fear and how I failed. I fall sometimes. It's hard to walk and shift in sand. The rock and find I'm nowhere left to stand and start to cry. Lord, please help me. I'll raise my hand so you can pick me up. Hold me close, hold me tight. Place Just how many storms it takes until I finally know you're here always, even when my skies are far from gray. I can stay, teach me to stay there. I have found a place where I can. Child who's held throughout a storm, you keep me warm in your arms of love.
If you would please take your copy of God's Word, and we'll be in 2 Corinthians this morning, the fifth chapter, 2 Corinthians chapter 5. There are eight verses that we are going to look at in this fifth chapter. We'll begin in verse 14 and work our way to the end of the chapter, which will be verse 21. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, beginning in verse 14. If you have an outline or a bulletin there, you'll see that there is an outline on the inside there. So feel free to use that. I've titled this sermon, What a Savior. I didn't know what else to say about this beautiful passage as Paul is reminding us of many wonderful things that we receive because of our faith in Christ. But having found your place in God's Word, let's go and ask Him to bless the preaching of His Word. Would you pray with me once again? Father, as we come to this point of looking into your Word, Lord, I pray that these will be your words. Lord, just speak through me right now as the Spirit is with us, Lord. And Father, I just again pray for the one today that maybe has not made that decision to follow you. Lord, I pray for those that do follow you, but Lord, at times life gets tough. And Lord, maybe there's something in our life that we need to confess or something that we're not doing that we need to be doing. Lord, just remind us of that, Lord, and let us be faithful. Lord, again, thank you for each person that is here. Thank you for each person that is listening or watching today. Father, we just want your name to be uplifted. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Well, basically two main points that I want to bring out of this passage. And first of all, the first four verses, we're going to look at our relationship with Christ. And then the last four verses come out of our relationship, and that is our responsibility to Christ. Now, really, all eight verses deal with our relationship and our responsibility, but when we get into it, you'll kind of see how it's divided. So let's begin. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 14, this is the Apostle Paul. And folks, I want you to hear this. Life is tough, but this is the power right here as we're listening to Paul explain here what it means to be a follower of Christ. So we begin in verse 14. Let's look at verse 14 and 15. For the love of Christ compels us because we judge thus, that if one died for all, then all died. And he died for all that those who live should live no longer for themselves, but for him who died for them and rose again. So again, these first four verses, two of which I just read, we're talking about our relationship with Christ and some of the things that we need to remember. And we see from these first two verses, verses 14 and 15, that our relationship with Christ should compel us to serve the Lord. Now, Paul is going to talk about this in a lot of his writings. For Paul, on that Damascus road, when he had that encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ, it forevermore changed him. I mean, he went from Saul, the persecutor and murderer of Christians, to Paul, the mighty evangelist, to the Jews and the Gentiles. And so he never got beyond what Christ had saved him from. And so he said, when we think about what Christ has done for us, it ought to compel us to want to serve the Lord. Now, folks, let's look at an illustration. I don't want to insult your intelligence, but sometimes it helps us to nail down a theological truth if we can relate it to something that we understand. Imagine the way this auditorium is divided is perfect for this illustration. Imagine this aisle right here is our life. I mean, you can say it began when we were born, but it really began when we trusted the Lord Jesus Christ, whatever day that was. By the way, if you hadn't done that yet, I have been praying for you all week that today would be the day you see who Jesus is and understand that he can save you from every fault, past, present, and future. But anyway, imagine that this is our life, and imagine that the sound booth back there, you guys are in heaven. That's heaven. And that's, we're heaven bound if you've trusted Christ. Now, if we've not trusted Christ, we're hell bound. I mean, that may seem harsh, but the Word of God proclaims that. If we're out of Christ, then our sins are still on us. And if we die in our sins, that's not going to be a good thing. But you know, we don't have to die in our sins. So imagine this is our life. We're heaven bound and we're going along. Our eyes are to stay on Christ. Amen? Our eyes are to stay on Christ. Amen? Y'all have masks on and you think you can't talk, but you can. I like for people to talk. It helps me know you're with me. So we're heaven bound. Our eyes are to be on Christ. But you know what? The world screams a lot of things at us, doesn't it? I mean, as we're doing our best to follow the Lord and we're on this walk of faith, and that's what it is, because we don't know one step from the next, but the Lord does. So if our eyes are on the Lord, we're going to make it and we're going to be okay. But there's a lot of things screaming at us. There's the voice over here of telling us we're not good enough. There's the voice over here just screaming at us that our sins, you know, there's the sins that we seem to always, the besetting sin that stumbles us. There may be a voice screaming over here that, look at what you have failed at. God doesn't want you anymore. There's the voice of fear over here as we get older that we're going to be alone. I mean, all of these things are screaming at us, and it's so easy to listen to them, right? It's so easy to listen. Yeah, you're right, I am a sinner. How could God love me? It's so easy to fall into the fear. You're right, I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. What if God lets me down? And the devil is always whispering in our ears that God is going to let us down. But we know that's not true, right, Christians? Don't listen to the voices that are screaming at you. Keep your eyes on the Lord. Yes, we're going to fall into sin, but if we trusted Christ, we confess it, and God forgives it. Yes, there may be consequences to sin, and we may have to live with that, but you know what? If God has forgiven it, it's forgiven, and those consequences become part of our testimony, and we carry on. Yes, as we go down through life, there's going to be fears and disappointments and heartache. But you know what? Even in the midst of all of that, we have a heavenly Father that loves us and that sustains us, and we're going to make it to the other side. Here's what we need to remember. In the midst of all the chaos and all the things that goes on in life, Paul is saying here, we cannot forget what Jesus Christ has done for us. And if we remember that, then it should compel us. Look at it again. We saw it in verse 14. He says, for the love of Christ compels us. Now, he's not in particular talking about his love for the Lord, though we should love the Lord if he saved us. He's talking about the love that Christ had for him. What does Romans 5 verse 8 tell us? But God demonstrates his own love towards us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Isn't that something? I didn't have to clean my life up and say, hey, I'm ready for God now. I came to Him with all the brokenness, all the flaws, and I trusted in His Son, Jesus Christ, and I was saved. The love that Jesus has for us ought to motivate us. It ought to compel us that I need to be serving faithfully. My petty life that I had before Christ doesn't have to be the life that I have now, and it's not the life that I have now. Well, he goes on to make a comparison. Now, Paul is just skimming the surface here. He doesn't give a lot of details. If we go back in Romans, in particular Romans chapter 6, we'll understand what the latter part of verse 14 means. Let me point it out again. Look at the latter part. So the love of Christ compels us because we judge thus. He's saying we reason like this because of the Word of God. He says that if one died for all, he says that if one died for all, then all died. And he died for all, that those who live should live no longer for themselves, but for him who died for them, rose again. Now listen, what is he saying here? When Christ died on the cross, he took the sins of the world, all of the sins on him. He was perfect. He was sinless. That was the purpose in God sending Jesus to this earth, because God so loved us. And when Adam sinned in the Garden of Eden, man, that plunged the world into sin. One man sinned, and the world was plunged into sin. One man, Christ, came and died on the cross, and through his death, through his resurrection, all live. So what Paul is saying here, and he explains more in Romans, is he's saying when Christ went to the cross and died, we all died. When Christ was buried, we were all buried. When Christ was resurrected, we were all resurrected. Now, to make that take account for us, we've got to trust Christ, right? I mean, if you deny Christ, then what Christ did for you, though he's died on the cross for you, though he's rose for you, so that you can have forgiveness of sins, it doesn't take account if we don't trust and give our heart and life to Christ. We say that like this. We ask the Lord to come in and to be our Lord and Savior, to take control of our lives. Now, I'm building here, maybe taking more time than I need to, but I don't want you to miss this. Paul is doing an analysis here, and he's saying, because of my relationship with Christ, and he's saying, brothers and sisters, because of your relationship with Christ, here's what you need to keep in mind. Because Jesus has loved you so very much, because he's died on the cross for you, and through your faith in him, the old man has died. Through your faith in him, he took the penalty that you deserved. But when he resurrected, because of your faith in him, you've been resurrected to a new life. Because of all of that, it ought to compel you to serve him. You ought to live your life for him. Now, what is another byproduct of our relationship with Christ? Not only does it compel us to serve, but it changes our view of others. Now, loving others is a messy business. Amen? You ever had anybody get on your nerves? Ever had anybody that did not think the way that you thought that they should think? Christians, have you ever done something kind for somebody and they took it the wrong way? Or didn't act like they really appreciated it? Folks, dealing with other people is difficult. And just because we're Christians sometimes doesn't make that any easier. We like different foods. We like different music. Although it all should be honoring and glorifying to the Lord, we have different tastes. And so sometimes we can get crossed up. But do you know what? When we think about how much Jesus loves us and that he took the penalty on that cross that I should have taken and that he gave me eternal life, when we think about that, we don't see the world the way we used to see it. We don't see, well, there's an old scallywag over there, and they don't believe in Christ, and look at all the trouble that they're doing. Yes, we see that, but we look straight through it. We don't see that neighbor as somebody that gets on our nerves. We don't see that family member as somebody that we wish wouldn't come to Thanksgiving and Christmas. We look through all of that exterior of sin, and we see a soul that God has created and that Jesus died on the cross for, and that we should take the initiative that we could get in and love on them and influence them for Christ. That's what Paul says in the next verse. Look at verse 16. He's saying when we have faith in Christ, it changes the way we view others. Verse 16, therefore, from now on, we regard no one according to the flesh. Even though we have known Christ according to the flesh, yet now we know him thus no longer. Now, this raises the question, had Paul ever met Christ before he met him on that Damascus road as the resurrected, risen, ascended Christ? I mean, we don't know. Scripture doesn't tell us that. It's certainly within the realm of possibility that he had met Jesus at some point, because they would have been in Jerusalem together at times for different feasts. But you know, we don't know that. And really, that's not the point of the verse here. Paul is saying, we know of the historical Jesus that lived on this earth. But now we see him as the glorified, resurrected, sitting at the right hand of God, King of kings and Lord of lords. So he's saying if we see Jesus for who he is and we understand what Jesus has done in our heart, I may watch the news and see some political candidates right now that make me want to fall on the floor and pitch a fit and cry. But you know what? Instead of blaspheming them and saying all manner of evil about them, you know what I'm trying to learn to do? Pray for their soul. They need Christ. There may be a neighbor, like I said, that gets on your last nerve and you have nothing in common with, but I try not to see the sin, although we can't ignore it. God doesn't ignore it, but I see that they're a soul in need of a Savior. That's what Paul is telling us our relationship with Christ should do. It should compel us, because Jesus loves me so much. And by the way, back to the analogy of the road, how do you stay on this road? How do you keep your eyes on Jesus and not look at all the, or listen to all the voices that are screaming against us? You know how you do it? You stay in the Word of God and you stay on your knees. If sin is overpowering you, if discouragement is overpowering you, folks, this life is discouraging. How on earth do we look at the things we're looking at and not be discouraged? I'm going to tell you how you do it. You keep your eyes on Jesus, and the way you do that is you stay in the Word of God. And the more you read it, it becomes like food to you physically. If I go without it, I feel like my whole day is out of sorts. And we stay on our knees, and we talk to the Creator of this universe. It's a beautiful day out there, amen? We can talk to the Creator of this beautiful day. Oh, but I don't understand all of that. Here's what you need to understand. God created it all. God created us. He sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die so that we would not have to have the penalty of our sins on our backs. If we trust in Jesus through his death, burial, and resurrection, we have forgiveness of sin and eternal life. And then he kind of sums it up in the next verse. Remember, we're talking about our relationship, those that are in Christ. Look at what he says. In verse 17, we're made a new creation. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. That phrase there, in Christ, is one of the Apostle Paul's favorite phrases. He uses it 130 times, give or take, in the epistles alone. Or its equivalent, in Christ. What exactly does that mean? Well, Jesus actually defines it for us in John chapter 15, verse 5. Jesus is saying, I'm the true vine. What does he say? He says, I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you'll bear much fruit. He goes on to say, if you don't, then you're not able to do anything. So Jesus is basically saying here, to be in Christ, we understand, means we've acknowledged him as our Lord and Savior. We've asked him to come in and forgive all of our sins and to be our boss, to be our Lord, to be our God. But just like there's a lot of limbs that's been severed from the trees because of the hurricane. It's amazing to me how fast there's a lot of pine limbs and things laying on the highway just out of our neighborhood. And it's amazing. It's only been a few weeks, and yet those limbs have already died. They've already turned brown. Well, we understand it's because they're severed from their life-given sap that would have been in the trunk of the tree. That's what Jesus is saying in John chapter 15, verse 5. He's saying, I'm the source of strength. If you stay plugged into me, he says, you're going to bear much fruit. Man, I'm going to tell you, that's the best thing that can happen to a Christian is we be a fruit bearer for the Lord. Do you realize that's why so many Christians are miserable? Do you realize that's why so many Christians walk the aisle and I believe genuinely get saved? Folks, if you believe Jesus is God's son and you admit that you're a sinner and you ask Jesus to come in and forgive you, I don't care what anybody tells you. Based on the word of God, you are saved. And so if you get out of the love of wanting to read the Bible, or if you get out of the love of wanting to pray, or if you get out of the love of wanting to assemble together, it is because you have forgotten who you're plugged into, and that's Jesus Christ, and that he has created you to bear fruit. Now, you can go out in the world and have a good time and do a lot of things that are fun, but they never give true joy. See, the devil can give joy, but it's a joy that's temporary. It's a joy that's not real. Read in the Word of God. If we follow the Word of God, everything that God said to do as individuals, as a church, as a family, as a nation, when we do those things, even if they seem bizarre and the world thinks they're crazy, there's blessings in there and we're able to bear fruit. But when we think we can improve upon it and we can mix it up and twist it up and try to do it in a different way, there'll be pleasure for a season, but it leads to ruin. That's because the devil is a cheat and a liar. Folks, you want to be in Christ? Then trust him as your Lord and Savior. He is the vine. We are the branches. Christians, you want to have joy, complete joy, absolute joy, joy that is bubbling up and rolling over the top? Then bear fruit. Well, I don't know how to bear fruit. Well, a pine tree knows how to make pine cones because it's plugged into the trunk. If we're plugged into Christ, you're going to bear fruit. If you're not bearing fruit, sin has crept in. Confess it, let God forgive it, and get back on track. You want to be the church that God created us to be? It's going to mean every woman, boy, girl here has got to keep their eyes on Christ, realize that God saved us for a purpose, and that he's got a plan for us. Does that excite you? Man, y'all look so depressed right now. I'm telling you, the creator of this universe thinks I'm special, not because of anything I've done, but because of what Jesus did for me. Man, he wants to partner with us. Isn't that something? The angels could carry on the ministry. But no, God says, I want my redeemed brothers and sisters, children in Christ, to do my bidding. All right, there we have it. There we have it. Therefore, if anyone's in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things become new. Turn to your brother and sister to the right or to the left in front of them. I want you to do this. Tell them you are a new creation if you are in Christ. Go ahead. Hear it again. If you are in Christ, you are a new creation. Don't let that sin have power over you. It's already been defeated at Calvary's cross. Don't let that discouragement tell you you're not good enough for God. None of us are good enough for God. But in his love, he saves us and sustains us and wants to use us. Now let's get into our responsibility. What have we looked at in the first four verses? Not to insult your intelligence, but I want to make sure you're with me. What have we looked at thus far? Paul is kind of stepping back. And he's like, you know what? Because of the love that Christ has for me, because he has saved me from being a murderer, because he has saved me from every sin, because he's given me a new heart, a new life, and an eternal life, because of all of that, I have to serve him. I have to live for him. Folks, think about this. Think about this. And maybe this has happened to some of you in here. Have you ever had a need that you were unable to meet? I mean, all of us have, right? Let's just say there's something wrong with a vital organ. I don't know, maybe there's a kidney problem. And maybe some of you can relate to this, but there's a physical problem and you're in the hospital and you've done all of the medications and all of the treatments and you've went through it all and it just seems to get worse and worse and worse. And literally you're getting toward the end. Wouldn't it be awesome for them or someone or a family member or someone that's an organ match to donate you the organ that you needed to live? How would you feel toward that person? Man, I can't imagine how I would feel if I'm laying there knowing I'm going to die and never see my daughter reach the age of 10, never get to enjoy the presence of my wife again, never get to love on you as my congregation. What if I'm laying there? I mean, hallelujah, I know I have heaven to look forward to, but I can imagine if something could be done, if an organ could be donated and the procedure taken, I mean, man, I would be all for that. Yes, do the surgery, and that person, I would never, ever get over the sacrifice that they made for me. Well, maybe you can't relate to the health. What about a financial woe? We're living in uncertain times, but God is always certain, amen? What if you have a debt? And I'm not saying it's your fault. Something has happened. The economy's been crazy with COVID-19 and all the things that are going on. And there's a debt. And maybe some of you are in that position right now. And just all I can say is trust the Lord. He is going to get you through it. But let's just say there's a financial need. And man, I mean, you owe more money than you can comprehend. And you're about to lose everything. I mean, you're going to be lucky if you get out with the clothes on your back. And you're thinking, what am I going to do? How am I going to provide for my family? And then all of a sudden, a friend or someone you don't know calls you up and says, I'm going to pay every penny of the debt. You don't owe a bit of it back to me. You don't have to do anything other than just receive the gift. I mean, my word, if we knew we were about to lose everything, I mean, that would be the greatest blessing. Well, folks, is that not what Jesus Christ has done for us? We had a sickness that's worse than kidney failure, and it is called sin. And the Word of God tells us that everyone has sinned because Adam sinned, and we all were plunged into sin. The Word of God tells us that because of that sin, we are separated from God. And because of our separation, we're going to spend eternity in a place called hell where there's fire that is never quenched, and there's no end to it. And yet, in that terrible, sick situation, at the step of death, Jesus Christ offers salvation. Who in the world would not accept that? And folks, the debt, back to the analogy of receiving money to pay all your debts from that blessed person that would do that, folks, we couldn't pay the sin debt. We can try to be good. We can give to our neighbor. We can do all the things that we do. But folks, the truth of the matter is we can't work to earn our salvation. Our good works are like filthy rags. All we have to do is trust Jesus. He has the cure for the disease of sin. As a matter of fact, sin was so fully conquered on Calvary's cross that the devil can bring it up in our lives all he wants to, and it doesn't change the fact. It has been conquered. Death has been conquered. Folks, the thing that is tripping you up and keeping you from walking faithfully with the Lord, listen to me, it has been conquered. Amen. We've just got to trust the Lord and keep going. I'm telling you, I get tired of feeling the way that I do sometimes, and it's just the devil, and I get tired of seeing the devil ruin Christians' lives. Folks, Jesus loves us so much, it ought to compel us to be here every time the door is open, minus the few times we have to go somewhere. We ought to love Jesus so much that we sing about Him, we talk about Him, we hum about Him. Man, people ought to be able to look at us and say, that's a Jesus follower, even before they open their mouth. We have got it, the words of life. How dare we sit on the pews and act like we've lost our best friend? Man, I'm not negating the fact that life is hard. I know things make me cry, but folks, just remember, God loves you. He sent His Son Jesus to die for you. Trust Him. Love Him. It changes the way we look at the world. We're a new creation. All right, our responsibility. Not going to say too much more, because the next four verses basically remind us of two things. We're in the ministry of reconciliation. Ha ha. joke's on you. You thought I was the only proclaimer of the gospel, right? I hope you don't think that. God has called me to shepherd this church. And you will never, ever, ever know the responsibility that is until you walk in my shoes. I am not perfect, and you well know that. I've been here almost a year and a half. But it's something I take very seriously. And I'm learning as I go, and I thank you for your patience. But I'm going to tell you what, I'm not the only one here that's called. Every follower of Jesus Christ is called to make disciples. We're called to be in the ministry of reconciliation. What does that mean? Brother so-and-so, sister so-and-so is out of the will of God because of their sin, or they've never trusted Christ. And God's on one side and they're on the other. Jesus has bridged the gap. It is our job to help them see that Jesus has bridged the gap, and that if they trust Jesus, they can be in perfect relationship with God, and ever how much time they got left here on this earth really is in God's hands. They don't have to fear death. They don't have to fear the judgment. They just have to follow the Lord. And that's what Paul reminds us of here. Look at the next two verses, verses 18 and 19. He talks about God's ministry of reconciliation, and he talks about our ministry of reconciliation. Look at verse 18. Now all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself and imputing their trespasses to them, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of reconciliation. Notice the first phrase there in verse 18. Now all things are of God. Isn't that something? Do you get the magnitude of that? Folks, who took the initiative in your salvation? God did. Now, as far as our memory, we can remember maybe the parent praying for us, the person that led us to Christ, the service that we were in when it happened. But do you realize before we were even born, Christ died on the cross for us? Before the foundation of the earth, before Adam ever sinned in the garden, God's plan of salvation was already in play. It's not like Adam sinned in that garden and all of a sudden God's like, man, I didn't see that coming. Before the foundation of the world, we can't even comprehend that. God's plan of salvation was already there. God took the initiative in our salvation. Now, the time came when we had to be obedient. We had to accept the free gift of salvation. Do you need scriptural evidence for this? Do you remember in Genesis 3, after Adam and Eve sinned in the garden? Of course, it plunged the world into sin. But do you remember shortly after God came down in the cool of the evening to walk with Adam? What did Adam and Eve do? They hid. They're like, oh my goodness, we're naked. We've never noticed that before. See, they understood the knowledge of good and evil. And so they hid. And God came down and said, where are you? Now, he did not ask this because he didn't know where they were. The questions of God are always for our benefit. It's just like Jesus asking the disciples, where is your faith? He knew where it was. It was floundering on other things. He's like, put your faith back in me. So God says, where are you? And they said, we hid. And no doubt they were afraid. They were ashamed. We're naked. We didn't know what you were going to do to us. We sinned. The point of that little analogy, of that reminder of Genesis 3, is Adam and Eve didn't sin and then run after God because they needed a Savior. No, Adam and Eve sinned, hid in the bushes, and God came after them. It's the same way with us. We would never get saved if Jesus hadn't come. My word, today he may be dealing with you in your heart, and he's reminding you, you're religious, you've put a good show, you've put up a good fight, but maybe he's reminding you right now that you've never trusted Jesus, that your sins are still on your head, and you may not understand all of that in a theological way, but you understand it in a real way in the fact that you're uncomfortable right now because you know you're separated from God. My dear friend, you don't have to stay there. And so Paul reminds us of that. And notice here he says, and the latter part of verse 18, and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That's what I've been saying. It's our responsibility not to look at people according to the flesh anymore. And that's not saying we overlook their sins. Jesus didn't overlook sin. He would deal with the sin and love the sinner. And that's what we need to remember, folks. It's easy to judge, and it's easy to put people in our shoes, but we've not been in their shoes. We don't know what the devil, what roadblocks he's put before them. And it's hard not to judge other people. It's hard not to look down on other people that don't seem as spiritual as we are. But the truth of the matter, God died for them, and he rose for them. We need to see them as people that need the Lord. Folks, you want to talk about God taking the initiative? Let me see if I got time for it. I do. Don't you love the prodigal son? Don't you love that story? Here you have a father with two sons, and the youngest one has the audacity to say, "Father, let's pretend you're dead. Go ahead and give me my inheritance." And the father, it must have broke his heart. He must have thought, "I know what's going to happen to you. I've seen the spirit in your eyes. You're going to get off in that far country, and it's not going to be good." But you know, sometimes we have to hit the bottom to be able to look up. So the father divided the inheritance. The younger son got his portion. And remember, the word of God says he left and went to the far country. And no doubt he lived it up. He was young, probably good looking, and he had money. And so he just had a good time. All that the world could offer, he experienced it. But you know, a famine came in the land where he was, and he ran out of money. And the poor little guy had to go hire himself as a pig feeder. And there he is, feeding these pigs, starving to death. And he looks at their food, and he's like, "My goodness, I wish I could eat their food." And then he begins to think. He's like, "You know, my father's a righteous man. My father is a good man. My father is a man that demonstrates love. And you know what? I'm remembering back, even though I'm his son, I'm remembering back when I lived at home. My father has a lot of servants, and his servants never went hungry. He treated them like sons. They always had everything they needed to eat." He's like, "You know what? I'm no longer worthy to be his son because I've slandered him. I've taken all of his money. I've lived in a way that's not becoming of my father's son. But you know what? I'll go back to him and I'll confess I have sinned before heaven and before you. And he I'll ask for forgiveness and I'll tell him I'm no longer worthy to be your son. Hire me as one of your servants." And he's starving to death. And he's like, "You know, I'm going to do that. I'll be one of my father's servants." So he makes his way home in rags, starving to death, probably smell like the pigs. And he gets there, and the farmhouse is just over the hill. Can you imagine what must have been going through his mind? He's been rehearsing this speech all the way home. "Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. Make me as one of your servants." Oh, Lord, he must have said that a million times. And then he gets to the last bit of property, and he's going over that. "Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be your son. Make me as one of your servants." And before he can get the latter part out, "Make me one of your servants," what happens? The father comes running out, embraces him, hugs him, and the father begins to give orders. He says, "Go get a robe. My son's in rags. Go get a ring. He's part of my family. Look at his feet. Give him new sandals. And by the way, go kill the fatted calf. We're going to celebrate. My son that was lost is now found." Folks, that's what the Lord has done to us. We don't deserve to be his children. We don't deserve to be his sons and daughters because we've sinned and we do it again and again and again. We do it before Calvary, before we accept Christ, and even after we accept Christ as Christians, we fall into sin. But the truth of the matter is, the Father was watching for that son, no doubt anticipating every day, will today be the day that he comes home? Folks, that's the Lord today. If you are living in accordance to his will, he rejoices in that. He sustains you to continue it. But if today you need salvation or you're out of the will of God, he still loves you and he's watching and he's waiting. It's not until the son admitted that he had sinned before heaven and before his father that it turned everything around. That's what we've got to do, folks. Confess the sin. Oh my goodness, God will forgive. And his arms are wide open, and he's saying, "I know you messed up. I know you've done wrong, but I forgive it. I cleanse it. Oh, my dear Christians, can I say this? So many times we confess a sin, and we know based on the Word of God that God has forgiven it. But folks, we can't forgive ourselves, right? I mean, chances are maybe some of you have done something in your past and you know God has forgiven it, but you can't forgive yourselves because it hurt people that you love. It caused things to happen that you wish would not have happened. Folks, that's all of us. But you know what? Here's what I remind you of, and I've said it before. If you've confessed it as sin, God is faithful and just and will forgive it. And don't let those consequences of the past, if there's something you need to do now, do it. If there's someone that you've hurt and you've never asked for forgiveness or you've never done your best to make it right, we need to do that. But folks, when you've done all that you can do and you've confessed it as sin, it is forgiven. Let the mistake become part of your testimony. Do you realize most of what we use in Scripture is not only people's triumphs, it's their tragedies? Man, I preached from Jonah last week. How many souls have come to faith in Jonah because he was disobedient to God? Don't think you're disqualified from serving the Lord because you've got some consequences from your past. God has forgiven it if you've asked Him to, and He is going to use you in the future. That mistake may be part of the testimony that will change someone's life. All right, so we have the ministry of reconciliation, which means we are ambassadors. What does an ambassador do? The ambassador represents the interest of his kingdom in a foreign land. Folks, earth is not our home, though we were born on it. If we've trusted Christ, we're citizens of heaven. That is our eternal home. And we are to be ambassadors of heaven, which means I can't say I'm ignorant of what the Word of God says, because God says back to me, I've given you a brain, read the Word of God, and know what the rules are of heaven, and tell other people about it. All right, ambassadors. Verse 20. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ as though God were pleading through us. Did you notice that? He could have used angels. He could have done it himself. But he saves us. He's pleading through us. Oh, my goodness. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ as though God were pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled for God. For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in Him. Wasn't that something? Jesus had never known sin, yet He took our sins on Him. We had never known righteousness, yet because of Jesus taking our sins, we took on His righteousness. Oh, my goodness, that ought to put a smile on every face here. Folks, I know our time is running out. So much here that could be elaborated on in so many different ways. Now, I'm closing my Bible, but you don't. This don't mean pack up and stop listening. Here's where we put it together, folks. Oh, my goodness, I pray that this has been clear and that the Holy Spirit has taken it. What is Paul saying? Because of our relationship in Christ, because we're a new creation, because we look at the world and people differently, it should compel us to serve the Lord. God didn't just save us to sit on pews. He didn't just save us to twiddle our thumbs and whittle the time away until it's time for us to depart from this earth. He saved us for a purpose, and that is to be reconciling the world to Him. God does the saving, but we're the mouthpieces. We're the ones that are able to show people the love of Christ by our words and our deeds. Folks, that is our responsibility, to be reconcilers. Really, God is the reconciler through Jesus Christ. We're just the ambassadors that tell people about it. And what is the message that we tell? That Jesus took our sins and we gained His righteousness. Don't you know now, as believers in Christ, when the Lord looks at us, He doesn't see the flaws. He doesn't see the shortcomings. He just sees the blood of Christ. It's all been forgiven. Now, we have a responsibility there. That's what Paul talks about in Romans 6. We can't say, well, I'll live whatever I want to live. The sins have been forgiven. No, go back to the analogy of the person that gave you money when you were in debt, or the person that donated a kidney when you needed one. Folks, we don't need to forget the sickness of sin and what Jesus has done. We don't need to forget the penalty of sin and how through faith in Christ the Lord has removed that. We ought to be so in love because Jesus loved us first. Folks, How do you treat the people that love you? You love them unconditionally. Well, folks, if God has demonstrated his love through Christ, it ought to compel us to serve. And part of that serving means to get our heart and life right and to love other people and help them come to faith. That's what Jesus meant in John 15:5 when he's talking about being plugged into the vine and bearing much fruit. That's what he's wanting us to do. Fruit for the kingdom as we work and serve and love other people and help them to work and serve and love other people. Folks, what do you need this morning? Do you have a burden on your heart that is tearing you to the core? Is there something that keeps you awake at night? Folks, I want to remind you, God is aware of it, and he loves you. And he may choose to remove it, or he may choose to give you the grace to live with it. But folks, don't let it rob you of the joy that you have of the love of Christ. Don't let it rob you from taking another day and serving the Lord to the best of your ability. Folks, maybe somebody's listening to me this morning, and they've never trusted Christ. Your name may be on a church roll somewhere. You may be able to quote scripture even. But folks, it all comes down to the point that man is on this side of the cliff, and God is on the other. And I can think and tell you every good work, and if we were to go around the room and say, what's a good work? Ever how many people are here, that's how many good works we could come up with. Not one of them will get us across the gulf to God. Not one of them. I could give up everything I own and go preach to people in a third world country, and if I've not trusted Christ as my Savior, I will die and go to hell. I can come and be a part of this church every Sunday, every Wednesday, and every other event that it has, and if I have not trusted Christ, I'll just jump off into the gulf and fall into hell. But I'm going to tell you what. When we acknowledge that Jesus Christ is our bridge to God, he took my place on that cross so that I would not have to die. Now, this body will go to dust, but my soul and spirit will go with the Lord because I've trusted Christ. He's the bridge that gets us to God. And nobody, the devil himself, can't take that away once we're in the Lord's arms. You may doubt your salvation. Remember this, salvation is not a feeling, it's a fact. If you've acknowledged that you're a sinner and trusted Jesus Christ as your Savior, you're as saved as a person can be. Now, you can be out of the will of God. It's possible to be in Christ and be right with God as far as the world sees you and be sinning in your heart. And us as Christians can do that. But salvation speaking, you can't lose your salvation. You might lose your fellowship with the Lord. And sometimes as Christians, we just have to confess, Lord, I've made a mess. Please forgive me. It's our time of invitation. It's your time to do what God wants you to do. Do you need Jesus Christ? I'm going to ask you to do something that's terrifying because it was terrifying for me. But when we give the invitation, you may not understand hardly anything I said today, but here's what you understand if the Lord has revealed it to you. I'm a sinner. I believe Jesus is God's Son and that he died on that cross for me. I trust him. I put my faith in him. I know he's God's Son. Oh, come into my life, Lord. Be my Savior. He'll do it. Christians, are we really living our life to where we're reconciling people, helping them see that they need the Lord? Remember, God is really doing the reconciling. We're just reminding them of the process that they need to trust Jesus. Let me pray for you. Folks, as we come to our hymn of invitation, oh, Lord, I lift up each person that is here. Lord, I pray for those that are listening that if they have not trusted Christ, oh, Lord, I just pray that they would give their heart and life to you. Father, I pray for the Christian, Lord, that is just discouraged right now. Lord, when we think of the great love that you have for us, Lord, it ought to motivate us to serve you and to want other people to know about you. Lord, we are new creations. You took the sin, and we gained your righteousness. Oh, Lord, we thank you for your goodness. Be with the one today that needs to make a decision. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.